Hello friends, looking at current affairs for 7th May, Sunday. The news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are around 24. So on Sundays, we generally have a few more supplements. So there are little more news, especially on science and tech coverage. So the first news item is RBI looks to Army for Operation Shredded Notes. So the demonetized notes which have been accumulated and are presently in custody with RBI, they need to be shredded. Destroyed. So for that, the army's help is being sought by RBI because it says that security concerns are also there. So that is where this is the news presently. Next is, we have doubts on China's Obor project, Jaitley. So the finance minister, Mr. Arun Jaitley, has given a statement that India has concerns over Obor project. So we are not participating in the Belt and Road Forum for International Cooperation, which is being held in Beijing in May now. So it starts from 14th of May. China has been trying hard to bring India on board, but we are objecting to this project because majorly a part of it, of this Obor project, is China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, and this corridor passes through POK. So this is our sovereign territory. We have concerns here. That is why we have refused to participate in Obor. So if China addresses this concern, we can go ahead and participate. So that is one point put forth. So what is this Obor? It's called Obor, One Belt, One Road Initiative, or it's also called Belt and Road Initiative. And it comprises of two parts. So one is the economic belt and one is the maritime road. So this is the economic belt, you can see, by road and by waterway. So here you can see it starts from China and it goes up to, you know, getting access to Europe also through Turkey. And then here also, again, you can see it starts from China and reaches West Asia and also Africa. So this is the maritime Silk Road. So here now what to think is that it has been possible for China to initiate such a huge infrastructure development project. So this is roadways, waterways being facilitated. This has been possible because China has a huge amount of foreign exchange. So this forex reserve which it has to be put to some effective use, because money staying idle is of no use. So that is why it is investing. Infrastructure is one aspect which requires huge amount of investment. And if infrastructure is developed, that would further boost China's economy, which is based on manufacturing. So cheap manufacturers and a huge amount of manufacturing base which China has. It has proliferated, it has spread. Trade through China has spread all over, to USA, to India. So you get made in China products all over. So then if and infrastructure is facilitated, and trade will further get a boost from China. So that, and also its forex reserve, once invested, it would get returns on it too. So that is how it has. And of course, another aspect is also strategic importance, because this will give China strategic hold over various countries also. So its relations with various countries also get a boost. So on resources too, the way we see with Africa also, when it puts investments are done by China in these countries, then the hold which China gets over their reserves also is there. So that are the benefits which China looks into. And India, of course, infrastructure development per se is important. So India would of course be benefited if infrastructure is developed in our region also. But then this concern which we have is of sovereignty. The sovereignty issue because of this China-Pakistan economic corridor. So it goes up to Gwadar port. This Gwadar port is also the port which China has developed in Pakistan. So this is also in Balochistan region in Pakistan. So here the route was also changed later because this is the region of unrest in China, in Pakistan. So China changed the route here. Then the next news item is 500 school students fall ill after chemical leak. So around 500 students and teachers, security guards fell ill in these schools in Delhi's Tughlakabad region because of a container which was moving, and it had stopped for some time here. So this was container full of chloromethyl pyridine. So this chloromethyl pyridine is used as for manufacturing of pesticides and insecticides. So this had leaked from here, and that had resulted in this disaster here. They were admitted to hospitals. There were no casualties as such. So it causes irritation, redness, watering of eyes. So such disasters need to be averted too. An inquiry has been sought in this matter too by Delhi government and even by the central government. So this is one incident here. Next is, Kolkata doctor gets Asian award. So this is Dr. Jack Prager. So he is the also called pavement doctor in Kolkata. So he's been honored with the Asian award, which is philanthropist of the year 2017. So that's the title awarded to him. So this is the first time that this Asian award has been given to a non-Asian person, and that to a living person. So last year it had been received and it had been conferred on Mother Teresa, but then it was posthumous award, means post her death. So this is the first time that a non-Asian living person has been awarded this Asian award, philanthropist of the year. So he has been working for the servicing the poorest of the poor people with healthcare facilities for the last 38 years. Next is focus on cold chain for safety of vaccines. So vaccine, we are trying to provide universal immunization in India. So the universal immunization program caters to a huge population of infants and pregnant women in the country. But then we see a number of vaccines go waste too, because the vials, even before they are opened, they lose their potency. Means they don't remain potential, they fail to function because of not being stored effectively. So there is a cold chain required to ensure that they are stored at temperature controlled environment. So that is the temperature controlled supply chain which is required throughout, in storage, in transportation and distribution. So that is the cold chain facility which is being focused on now to ensure safety of vaccines and achieve 90% vaccination, which we are targeting by 2021. So this is the case. In India, number of child deaths occur due to vaccine preventable diseases. So if vaccination and the immunization program is strengthened, then this would be averted. Next is Farakka barrage not to blame for Bihar floods. Uma. So this is the Union Water Resource Minister Uma Bharti responding to the allegation made by Bihar Chief Minister Mr. Nitish Kumar that the Farakka barrage has resulted in floods in Bihar during the last monsoon. So the Water Resource Minister Ms. Bharti is saying that it is not the Farakka barrage which needs to be blamed for floods in Bihar. So the Chief Minister of Bihar, Mr. Nitish Kumar, was blaming Farakka barrage. So you can see here, Farakka barrage is here. So this Farakka barrage is, originally the intention was that it should regulate the flow of water here so that Kolkata port remains navigable. So it's a barrier to water body. So this is the Ganga River here, you can see. So how much water should coming out, it can be regulated here. But because of Farakka barrage, now silting has started accumulating. So the river water will carry silt along with it too. So this silt, when it is deposited here, an accumulation of it results in water body levels rising. And that is why Nitish Kumar, Bihar Chief Minister, has stated this has resulted in floods in Bihar. But then the Farakka barrage, the response of Union Water Resource Minister Ms. Bharti to this is that for that, what should be done is that the National Waterway 1, which is from Allahabad to Haldia, should be developed so that this silting does not take place and this Farakka barrage should not be blamed. So you can see this National Waterway 1 is from Allahabad to Haldia, comprising of Ganga. This is called the Bhagirathi River route, and then this is the Hugli River. So this will be the route which will be there for the National Waterway 1. So once this is developed, then silting issue will not be there anymore. But then another concern which is raised is that even in this National Waterway 1 project, there'll be barrages which will be established, and that would further result in silting taking place. So how would that be taken care of is also a question. So this is the whole issue here. Then next is quality of water has improved. So this is the World Water Council, which had conducted its survey all over the world, including in India. So here the response was taken from the people, and it said that 31% of Indians believe that sanitation and drinking water facility is unsafe still in India, while around 60+% population said that situation has improved. So this is the response from the survey. The 8th World Water Forum will be held in March 2018, next year in Brasilia, Brazilian capital. So this survey has been done ahead of that. So this is regarding the World Water Council. It's an international think tank founded in 1996, headquartered in France. So here it has 341 members, which includes organizations from the UN, intergovernmental organizations, private sector, as well as government and ministries. So this is the World Water Council. So it's to promote awareness, build political commitment and trigger action on critical water issues. So water is a huge major concern presently, as we see, with respect to climate change too. So this World Water Council is held every third year by the World Water Forum. So this is the largest event on water. So the theme for the 8th World Water Forum in 2018 is also sharing water. So that is a major concern amongst the states also in India, and of course at bilateral level too this is a concern. Then next is Namami Gange set for rebranding push. So this is regarding the Namami Gange program. So Narendra Modi government has completed is in its third year presently. So this flagship program is still not seen moving ahead. So now a rebranding exercise would be done. Top advertising agencies have been roped in to and establish another advertising campaign, creating awareness among the people so that the Ganga River is not polluted. Because we see that pollution is done on a huge extent on River Ganga. So this, it says, the proposed campaign, it is mentioned, it should evoke the strong soul connect with the Ganga and leverage associated emotion to drive active participation of the people. So this is the notice from the government that on this basis, advertisement should be done so that Ganga cleaning gets awareness too and people do not pollute the Ganga River anymore. But then the question is that already there is a huge amount of sewage which enters into River Ganga from households and from the industries too. And this sewage should be treated and then drained out into the river, but then sewage treatment plants are still not there. So there are, you can see the details given here. There is 12,000 million liters per day of sewage which empties into River Ganga. And this meanders through 11 states from Uttarakhand to West Bengal. And the capacity is there presently, sewage treatment plant capacity is only for 4,000 million liters per day. So this is a huge lacuna which you can see. So that is the problem, that only plants with 1000 million liter capacity are presently working. So this capacity worth is exists and this much is working, and that is the lacuna. So you can see that if sewage treatment is not done, then the Ganga River water pollution will not be easily tackled. The Namami Gange program was started with a huge bank with 20,000 crore allocated to it. So it's a complete 100% centrally funded scheme. So earlier too, there were programs in 1985, we had this National River Conservation Program, even Clean Ganga Mission have been started, but they have not given results. So let's see what happens to Namami Gange also. And this National Mission for Clean Ganga is the body which looks into these cleanup programs, but then even ghat beautification, all these aspects are under it. But the allocation given to this program is only 2000 crore out of 20,000 crore. For sanitation. So sewage treatment plants require a huge amount of expenditure. So this is lacuna is seen. Another idea which has been discussed is Ganga Jyoti Yatra. So like an Olympic torch run, it would start from Kolkata and end in Varanasi. So this has also been planned to create awareness regarding Namami Gange program and cleaning River Ganga. So this is the route you can see River Ganga flowing through in India. Then the next news item is Nirbhaya, juvenile lives in anonymity. So we saw the Nirbhaya verdict yesterday. The Supreme Court upheld the death sentence awarded by the Delhi High Court to the four convicts. The fifth convict committed suicide in Tihar jail, and the sixth one was juvenile at that time of committing of the offense, and he is said to be the most brutal of the accused. And he was treated as a juvenile. The Juvenile Justice Board looked into the case and he was awarded 3-year detention. And post that, now he has been released. So in 2015, a petition was filed in the Supreme Court by National Commission, by the Delhi Commission for Women, asking that this juvenile should not be released because he has been radicalized, he has not reformed. But then the Supreme Court has said that the function of the Juvenile Correctional Center is to reform these youths. And if it has not, then the center has failed as such. So this is the case. Actually, even the juvenile law was demanded to be amended at this time because of this case, that juveniles in the 16 to 18 age group, if they are involved in heinous offenses, then they should be treated as adults. So this act has been passed. This Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act of 2015 was passed by both the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, and this has replaced the 2000 Act, providing for the same. But then this act came into force on 15 January 2016 and he was already, he did not come. That juvenile did not come under this act. So this is the status here. The next news is US keen to expand Malabar exercise. So this Malabar exercise is presently a trilateral exercise amongst USA, India and Japan. So actually, originally it was between two, India and USA, bilateral naval exercise. So it's been scheduled for July 2072 around Bay of Bengal. So this next edition would take place. And this started from 1992. when Japan was later added in 2015, and now Australia also wants to be part of the exercise, Malabar exercise in 2017. Both USA and Japan are keen on this, but India is reluctant because of the opposition which China has on this issue. So it was actually, you can see here, the exercise which had been held in 2007, Malabar exercise, that included not just India, USA, but also Japan, Australia and Singapore. And at that time, China had vehemently protested against this, that this is an emerging security axis in this region working against them. So to ensure that China is not antagonized, India is reluctant to add Australia into this exercise, though both USA and Japan are keen and have been working towards that. So this year's exercise, another aspect is that it would focus on anti-submarine warfare. So because of the increasing Chinese submarines presence in the Indian Ocean, this would be the focus of this exercise, Malabar exercise. Then the next news item is IIT Madras makes white light from pomegranate turmeric extracts. So this is regarding Dr. Vikram Singh, who is a former research scholar at IIT Madras. So he has been awarded Birag Gandhian Young Technological Innovation Award for 2017. So he, along with Professor Ashok Mishra from IIT Madras, they used a mixture of two natural extracts, red pomegranate and turmeric, and they produced white light emission through it. So the polyphenols you can see present in red pomegranate, they emit blue and orange red regions light wavelength, and turmeric, the curcumin present in turmeric, it emits green region light wavelength. So this, what happens is when these two are mixed, then white light is produced. So this is the first time that white light emissions have been generated using low cost edible natural dyes. So this has been the unique discovery. So this has wide variety of applications. So white light emissions can be used for tunable lasers, LED lights, white light display, etc. But the concern here is, since these are natural chemicals as such, so their stability is a concern, the chemical stability, because they undergo breakdown and then they have a tendency, natural components have a tendency to break down. So then it becomes difficult for their long lasting functioning. So that is why the photostability and chemical stability has to be taken care of, then only it will have further applications. So this is the research. The next news item is reversing drug resistance made possible. So antibiotic resistance is a major concern presently. So we see that bacteria develop resistance to various drugs, and then new drugs are required to be manufactured, synthesized. So what has been seen is that how this bacteria resistance can be blocked. So here, one other research which has come forth from IISc, Indian Institute of Science in Bengaluru, these researchers have found an enzyme that triggers the biosynthesis of hydrogen sulfide. So hydrogen sulfide is present in bacteria, which is synthesized, and this provides them antibiotic resistance. So if the enzyme that triggers it is disabled, then hydrogen sulfide will not be generated and they will not have antibiotic resistance. So this experiment has been done on E. coli bacteria, and they saw that the results were that nearly 50% reduction in drug resistance was possible when hydrogen sulfide production was blocked in the E. coli bacteria. So this is there. Also, genetically resistant bacteria, genetically resistant to antibiotics, these bacteria also are sensitive to antibiotics if hydrogen sulfide synthesis is inhibited. So this is the research which has come forth. The next is time for a national policy on thalassemia. So thalassemia is a genetic blood disorder. So what happens is, in this, there is abnormal production of hemoglobin in the body. So because of hemoglobin abnormality, it results in improper oxygen transport and even destruction of red blood cells. So what this requires is that blood transfusion should be given to the patient regularly. So this regular blood transfusion is required, because what happens because of this condition is that iron overload may take place, even bone deformities take place, in severe cases even heart related diseases occur. So another cure as such cure is not there for thalassemia, but one cure which is possible is that bone marrow transplant can be done. So if bone marrow transplant is done for thalassemia patients, then they can function, you know, normally later. But then this bone marrow transplant can also take place for children up to 10 years of age. Beyond that, if this transplant is undertaken, then there can be a serious risk as such to life. Plus, for bone marrow transplant, a relevant match is also required with a sibling or anybody else related. So this is also quite difficult in many cases. So this is one way in which this can be, and of course it's a huge cost involved in this bone marrow transplant. So here thalassemia awareness is required in the country, that is being highlighted. There is no national policy on this too. And how is thalassemia transmitted? It is a genetic disorder, means a thalassemia minor carrier can result in children who are thalassemia majors, and they would be affected. So there are around 40 million thalassemia carriers in the country and 1 lakh thalassemia majors in the country. They require blood transfusion every month. But still, so that is why India is called the thalassemia capital in the world, because in terms of population, this is a huge number. But yet we don't have any prevention and control program in place. The experts say that even a simple test done by the gynecologists for screening of thalassemia, whether the pregnant mother is a thalassemia carrier or not, will result in prevention and control of this disease. So this is being highlighted. So one positive development which has occurred presently is in the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act 2016, thalassemia has been added as a disability. So that is one thing. So this is the whole detail about thalassemia and the number of diseases which have been presently added under the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act. It has already been turned into an act of 2016. So originally the act, Disabilities Act, had provided for 7 disabilities recognized, but now they have been extended to 21 disabilities. So this is the list of disabilities, and you can see thalassemia is also a part here. So here you can see how thalassemia affects people also. So if both mother and father are thalassemia carriers, means they are thalassemia minors, they are carriers of the gene, and it means it's a recessive gene, you can see here. So this is the carrier gene. So they would not be affected by thalassemia, but then there are 1 out of 4 chances that the child would be affected by thalassemia. So this you can see, it gets this recessive thalassemia gene from both of them, then he would be affected. So this is the case. Then the next news item is new way to make methanol. So researchers have identified a new simple method to convert methane, which is a greenhouse gas, into methanol using water. So this can be very useful at the gas well sites, that gas could be converted into methanol liquid and then it can be easily transported. So this is a good way of converting a greenhouse gas into a substance which can be used as a liquid fuel or chemical for useful purposes. So this is the technique used here. You can see is that the metal containing zeolites are used. So this you can see copper exchange zeolite here has been used to convert methane into methanol using water. So this is the case. It has 97% efficiency. Then next is, what is XFEL? So this is X-ray laser. So X-ray free electron laser. So Europe has developed this, and this is the world's biggest X-ray laser which has been developed. So this generated its first beam of light last week. So that is why it is in use. So it is located underground in the underground tunnels in Germany. So this XFEL can be used in many scientific fields for medicine, pharmacy, chemistry, nanotechnology, etc. So it will provide sharp resolutions, filming images of chemical reactions also, viewing the internal structures of cells, membranes, etc. can also be possible through this X-ray free electron laser. So this is shown here. So this is the electron gun. So electron passes through this accelerator, this undulator, which is the magnetic field generated here, and then the X-ray laser is generated. So this is laser light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So this laser is generated through X-ray. Then next news item is quick test for Zika. So these researchers have used the LAMP technique. This is loop mediated isothermal amplification. So the amplification of DNA takes place through this, and the DNA samples of humans and mosquitoes have been used under LAMP, and it has been seen that this can be used to easily detect whether the Zika virus is present in human or mosquito samples. So these field tests have been undertaken in US, Brazil, Nicaragua, and it has shown results. So if this is successful, this quick test can be deployed so that harmful pesticides, etc. need not be used, and the cost for widespread spraying of for mosquitoes across the world can be reduced. So this is the test for Zika. So Zika virus has been in news for long now because of its recent spurt which took place in Brazil. You can see here. So these were the regions affected in South America and Central America here. So it resulted in a condition in children called microcephaly. So the pregnant women who were affected because of Zika virus. So this is the Aedes aegypti mosquito bite. This is the carrier of the Zika virus. So this resulted in Zika virus condition, and the babies born to such pregnant women have seen to be suffering from microcephaly. So their brain size, you can see here, this is less, and they have various disabilities which have been detected. It's called a complete spectrum of diseases which they have seen to be suffering from. So this is been found now. So vaccine is being developed. Presently there is no vaccine as such, no cure for Zika virus, but Zika virus detection will be facilitated through this LAMP technique. Then the next news item is NASA mission on solar system. So NASA has launched this New Frontiers program, and in this New Frontiers, the fourth mission will be selected presently. So scientific and technical review of proposed projects will be undertaken by NASA. So under New Frontiers, the already initiated three projects are: one is New Horizons mission, which went to Pluto, Juno mission to Jupiter, and Orisis Rex. So these three also, what are they? We'll see. The fourth one will be selected soon. So New Frontiers means it's going beyond. So Pluto, Jupiter, and reaching this Orisis Rex is going to an asteroid, Bennu. So we'll see what are they. So New Horizons mission is shown here, you can see. So the New Horizons mission of NASA to Pluto had been launched in 2006. It reached Jupiter also in 2007 and beyond. It reached Pluto in 2015. And finally, it has done its closest approach to Pluto and its moons. There are plans to extend this mission to further from 2070 to 2020 if NASA approves it, and it can be used to study objects beyond Pluto, that is in the Kuiper belt. So Kuiper belt is the belt as such which lies beyond Pluto in the solar system. So this is there. Next is the Juno mission, the second mission under the New Frontiers program of NASA. So this Juno mission was launched in 2011. It reached Jupiter and it was put into a polar orbit around Jupiter. It is being powered by solar panels. You can see these huge array of solar panels which power it. So this is the mission to Jupiter. It is studying the Jupiter's atmosphere, magnetic field, etc. So this is the mission. The third mission which was launched under the New Frontiers program of NASA was Orisis Rex mission. This was launched in September 2016. So this mission is to an asteroid. So this asteroid in the asteroid belt, which is between Mars and Jupiter. So this asteroid has been specifically been selected. This is the asteroid called Bennu. So this asteroid is speculated that there are chances that it may collide with Earth in 2175. So this makes it an interesting study. So to understand the asteroids too, this encounter with it would be done. Data would be collected, samples would be collected from its surface. It would be like a hi-fi which would be done with the asteroid, and samples being collected by this mission, and it would come back. So this is there. It would return to Earth back in 2023. So this is the Orisis Rex mission. The fourth under New Frontiers program of NASA would be selected now, the fourth mission. Then next is flashback in time. So this is regarding NASA's SOFIA, Stratospheric Observatory for Infrared Astronomy. So this is actually an aircraft in the stratosphere. Stratosphere is a layer in the Earth's atmosphere. So this lies above the water vapor region. So this provides this infrared astronomy data, and this data has been analyzed by NASA, and it has been confirmed that there is a nearby star system called Epsilon Eridani, which could be like an early version of our solar system. So this, the star is 1/5 the age of the sun. So the sun is a star, you should know that. So this is also a star around which there can be a complete solar system as such. So this also has a Jovian planet and an asteroid belt next to it, just like the Earth, the solar system of ours. So this is the data here provided through SOFIA. Next is Cassini finds vast void between Saturn's rings. So this is regarding the Cassini-Huygens mission of NASA. So this was launched in 1997. The Cassini spacecraft entered into Saturn's orbit in 2004. In 2005, Huygens, which was part of this mission, which was a lander. So Cassini is the orbiter and Huygens was the lander. It landed successfully on the surface of Titan, which is a moon of Saturn, where it was planned. So this Titan landing also took place of Huygens. Then Cassini also spotted, it was orbiting, Cassini was still orbiting, it spotted many lakes on Titan. In later it also spotted organic brew, organic liquid, which is present on Enceladus. So this also we have seen. Enceladus is another moon of Saturn. So this has already taken place, and Cassini has been doing observation of Saturn. It entered into the rings, in between the rings of Saturn. So that was the last news, and presently the news is that there is a huge amount of unexplored area between Saturn's rings, but it was seen that there is nothing much as such. So it's a big empty, as it has come out that the region between the rings and the Saturn is a big empty. So there has been nothing more coming forth from this mission. It could not detect anything, and now in September 2017 finally it has been planned that Cassini would plunge into Saturn's atmosphere and the mission would end. So this is regarding Cassini-Huygens mission. Then the next news item is a century of looking at our closest star, the sun. So this is regarding the Kodaikanal Solar Observatory in Tamil Nadu in India. So in since 1994, every day the telescope is aimed at the sun and images of the sun are freezed on a disk. So this images have been collected every day since 1994. So more than 100 years since it has been collecting this data. Later in 1909, you can see the data was also used to discover Evershed effect. So this is the effect, which is the name given to the effect that gases in sunspots flow radially outwards. So this was also detected because of these imagery. So these are called spectroheliograms, the images which are taken at Kodai Observatory. So now what has been done is a project has been undertaken to digitize all these images. So this initially it got this success, Evershed effect was discovered, which was a huge initiative. But then later after this discovery, nothing much happened and it entered into a decline, but images were taken daily. So now what has been done is, since the same machinery, everything, same tools were used to take this, the same telescope were used to take these imageries. What has happened is that the data is in the same format and all this has been digitized. So high resolution digital images have now been uploaded. They are open for public view. So this project had been undertaken, and this data is comprising of three set of images taken using three different filters, white light filter, H alpha and calcium K. So they give imageries of sun's photosphere, the sunspots are also visible, the chromosphere can be seen, and also the filaments, which are large expansion of materials from the sun's surface, all these can be viewed. And this has attracted international attention. Max Planck Institute of China, Beijing, all these institutes, Max Planck Institute of US, of America in Germany, and also this institute from China, and even Big Bear Solar Observatory from US have shown interest, and they want to study the sun's luminosity changes through these imageries. This is the news here. So you can see white light images show how sunspots appear and disappear periodically over an 11-year cycle. So they have made a film out of these imageries too, and they can be used for, you know, studying purposes also as teaching material. So this is the sun. So the outermost layer here you can see is the chromosphere, then is the photosphere. The corona is this outermost region where these solar flares also occur. So there's a convection zone, radiation zone in the sun. The core lies here. The sunspots which are there, the sunspots occur because of the magnetic field of the sun, and the sun rotates faster at the equator than at the higher latitude. So because of this, the magnetic field here bends. So these lines you can see are getting twisted, and then they turn into magnetic loops. So these magnetic loops which are generated, they are a strong field. They break through the surface, and the light here and the temperature here is quite low, and because of this, this appear as dark spots. So these are called sunspots, and they periodically change. So there's an 11-year cycle in which sunspots are visible. So this have been studied for decades now, and all this data is presently available through this institute's Kodaikanal Observatory's imageries. Then the next news item is Russia blocks Chinese social media app WeChat. So WeChat, the social media app of China, has been blocked by Russia because it says that WeChat refused to provide contact information for the regulators register in Russia. So that is why this has been blocked presently. Next is With GST regime, tough task ahead for firms. So GST is goods and services tax. It would be put into effect from 1st July 2017 as is intended. So for that, regulations have been coming forth from the government about how firms have to keep their data records regarding GST. So all registered tax paying entities under GST, as per the rules, they have to maintain records of import and export, all imported goods, exported goods, services and tax paid supplies separately for each activity. Means whether it's for manufacturing, trading, services, all have to be separately kept as in the records as such. And also the records have to have the complete address of premises where the goods are stored, including goods in transit. So huge amount of regulations, rules have been brought forth here. Also, it says that any entry in registers, accounts and documents should not be overwritten or deleted in any manner. And if there is anything as such done, so a log should be maintained of every entry edited or deleted. So this would be needed. So these are the regulations here you can see. The rules also require every registered entity to maintain its books of accounts in principal place of business as well as every other registered place under the new indirect tax law. So these regulations have been brought forth. Also, it says that this information should be preserved for 72 months from the due date of furnishing of annual return of the year. Also, another concern with respect to GST is of exporters, that exporters, because taxation would be collected as such at every stage, but then since it is a value added tax, there would be a refund coming forth, because at every previous stage where tax has already been paid, those taxation deductions would also come forth. So these deductions, the refund process as such will take time. So under the export, for the exporters too, the government has said that the 90% of the refund will be paid within 7 days and remaining will be paid in the next 4-5 months. So this is a huge amount of time, and the exporters feel, especially the small and medium players in the export sector, they feel that this would be a huge amount of money locked up for them. So this is an issue which has been raised by the Commerce Ministry to the government regarding the concerns of exporters. Then the next news item is drug makers face global pushback on high prices. So because of pharmaceutical companies now facing the fire because of various countries in USA, in European countries too, in Germany, in Britain, there is a pressure on these pharmaceutical companies to reduce the prices. So there's this term called fair pricing. So World Health Organization is also hosting a forum to promote fair pricing of pharmaceutical products. So this drug pricing debate, which is going on presently, it is said even China, Japan, they are also two big West, non-Western markets for pharmaceuticals. They are also calling for reducing the costs of pharmaceutical products. So what is happening is that new drugs are being discovered for these life-threatening diseases, but then if they are not easily available, affordable for the common people, then they are a huge obstacle for the purpose which they are supposed to serve. So this question has been raised. Also, there are calls that these R&D and production costs of these pharmaceutical companies for these drugs need to be disclosed as such. There should be greater disclosure so that an understanding can come about how the prices are being determined as well. So this is the case. Also, one more point put forth is that those drugs which are off patent, their patent has expired. So the generic version of these medicines, they should be cheap in principle is there. But then if the prices become quite low, unsustainably low, then the supply becomes a concern. So there is not enough supply then. So this is also a concern which WHO will try to address, World Health Organization. Then the last news item is Japanese men-only island up for global heritage site. So this is Okinoshima, which is an island in Japan. So this is a men-only island. So only men are allowed to come on this island. It is in Fukuoka prefecture of Japan, and it is planned to be given World Heritage Site status by UNESCO. So UNESCO advisory body has recommended World Heritage status to it. So here, even men who come on it should are required to strip down and perform a cleansing ritual, and then they can enter into the island. Also, there is a ban on women. The women cannot enter this island. So this was an ancient site and continues to preserve this antiquity. And it has also been discovered many gifts from overseas which have arrived on this island. So they are the national treasure of Japan presently. So this is the Okinoshima island. So these are the news items. Thank you.